Hello everyone, we are testing team 6 and as part of assignment 2, we will fuzz a real-world software and try to find crashes and analyze them. In doing so, we will also evaluate the performance of the fuzzer itself. The software that we are fuzzing is called ImageMagick because it is one of the most widely used image manipulation tools in Linux and has quite some vulnerabilities as you can see from the link given in the README file. To be exact, its utility convert is what we will be fuzzing. We're using two versions of ImageMagick. The older version is 6.7.7-10 and the latest version is 7.0.5-4. The reason why we're using these two versions is because we want to discover some bugs in the older version and see whether they have been fixed in the newer version and how exactly they have been fixed by looking at the source code. All information you need on how to set up the system is given in the README file along with links on extra information. We will first explain the setup. Then we will fuzz the two software, show you the results, and then we will move on to analyze one crash and one hang. We will conclude by telling you about some of the road bumps that we hit along the way that you should be considered about when creating the experiment. So let's begin. AFL is already installed as described in the README. The seed image archive was also downloaded here and the PNGs were copied to the test folders here. Now building the software. Go to each of the software directory and enter this command. We will be setting the compiler to AFL GCC, which is basically a wrapper over the standard GCC, but it also instruments the binary so that AFL can work on it. You can see that we've installed the older version. Now we can start fuzzing. Enter the following command to fuzz. We first specify the input directory as tests and output directory as findings. Then we write the utility name, which is convert. We enter these @ signs, which is where the AFL fuzzes the values. And lastly, we dump the outputs to dev null because we don't really care about the outputs. What we care about is whether a certain input causes a crash or a hang or not. Then AFL goes through all these test files and performs a brief dry run to see if any file immediately causes a crash or a hang, because then there would be no point to fuzz because it is already a potential solution. Now, this is how the fuzzing dashboard looks like. We are mainly interested in unique hangs and unique crashes. We can leave it running for at least a day or when at least one cycle is completed, which is when all the branches are covered at least once. We could only run it for maximum a day because of memory limitations. But here's a screenshot of our final state. We managed to find 25 crashes and 131 hangs in the older version of ImageMagick. Once done, proceed by fuzzing the latest version of ImageMagick by first installing it and then fuzzing it using the steps I showed you before. We ran the latest version of ImageMagick for more time, but we couldn't find any crashes in it. We could only find 112 hangs. For both the cases, we weren't able to complete even a single cycle because our systems ran out of memory. So now we analyze the crashes. We have a simple script here that quickly iterates over all the crashes and prints the output. We can see most of these are memory allocation problems and some of these are segmentation faults. So let's pick this file and copy it to a more central location for convenience. Now let's run convert in isolation to see what happens. It is a segmentation fault. Let's try to debug it. We run gdb convert and then we run the crash file. We can see that some of the source code is printed. Now if we print the value of quantum info, it gives us a null pointer. And quantuminfo.endian says we cannot access this memory. And it says it is in quantum.c, line number 133. So let's go to the source code. The method is called acquire quantum info. Well, this is a line of code that causes the crash. Let's put a breakpoint on it. And let's run it again. So we see that the value of status is magic false. And we see that the if block destroys the quantum information and then the developers are using quantum info variable again. This is an instance of use after free vulnerability. Let's see if this is present in the latest version as well. You can see that the version of convert we are using right now is the latest one. Running the command doesn't give us a segmentation fault anymore. However, there still seems to be an issue, but it seems like an explicitly handled exception. Let's look at the source code of the new version. And upon comparing, we can see that the developers have moved the line of code above the if block. So, for the second bug analysis, I will shift to another computer. We will now analyze a pretty severe bug we found, which can be exploited and can potentially constitute a denial of service attack on servers that use ImageMagick for image conversion. While this bug was originally found in the older version, it is still present in the latest version of ImageMagick. This bug is due to the excessive trust put into the headers of a PNM image file. The library keeps a cache in the form of a temporary file stored in the file system and keeps writing into it based on the number of columns and rows advertised in the header. It doesn't actually verify whether these values are true or even possible at all. As you can see, we're using the latest version of Convert. And this is the file that causes the hang, which was given to us by AFL. It was in the hangs folder. Since we don't have enough space in our system, we will use the external hard disk as the temporary directory. Let's quickly set the temporary directory to the external hard disk and then run convert. And let's monitor the process. So you can see that the amount of space that we have is reducing quite quickly. But it's not possible that a file of this size is taking that much space. So let's dig deeper with GDB about what's going on. So let's run GDB with convert and set the environment variable to our hard disk. And then we run the hang file again. We already know that it will cause a hang, so we'll just stop it after a while by pressing Ctrl C. And then we will run backtrace, hoping to see a useful stack trace. So this stack trace is pretty big, and we don't have the time to cover through all of the functions, but we will only look at the key functions causing the hang. In particular, write pixel cache region in cache.c. So let's open the file. So this function is responsible for writing into the cache. And this loop is responsible for filling up the cache. And this loop depends on the dimensions of the cache. The amount of data it writes into the cache depends on the dimension of the cache itself. And the dimensions of cache are stored in this variable called cacheInfo. And this variable called cacheInfo is initialized in a function called openPixelCache, which is called in line 1667, as you can see. So going back to the source code, locating the declaration of the cacheInfo structure, and we see that it is initialized here. And we can see that the rows and columns of the cache are the same as the rows and columns of the image. And the image structure is initialized in the read PNM image function. Let's set up a breakpoint in that function. And we should expect a hang when set image color in PNM.c is called. So we run the program again and we navigate through the code. And these are the values for the rows and columns of the image. So we see that the rows and columns are initialized to quite a large number. And if we keep running it, we should run into a hang. And there's the hang on line 440. Now if we go back to the header of the file, we can see in the header that the number of rows and number of columns are shown. So the main takeaway here is that we shouldn't trust the value of the header itself without verifying it, because it can be easily faked and they can actually be exploitable. Lastly, we talk about some of the considerations that you should keep in mind when trying to replicate this experiment as shown in our video. When deciding which software to fuzz, we face the problem of determining the right seed test case that would guide the search for AFL. For example, we tried to fuzz Python and then AFL itself, but couldn't because we didn't have interesting test cases, nor was AFL able to generate any, even after a day of fuzzing. So you might want to invest in good test cases before beginning. The developers of AFL claim that AFL can generate interesting test cases from non-interesting ones, but we argue that it is only possible given enough resources. So, if you don't have interesting test cases, make sure to have enough resources to allow AFL to generate some itself. Lastly, the unique hangs and unique crashes are not really unique at all. We found multiple files causing segmentation faults that all referred to a single line where the software crashed. While the path may be different, they are not exactly unique crashes. Moreover, the hangs are not really hangs at all. Out of 300 hangs, only 4 or 5 actually hung our system. So it seems that you can't take AFL's word for it. That concludes our video.